Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents A Matter of Hive and Death by Nancy Coco. Narrated by Susan Ericksen. Chapter 1. Oh, Wren, what do you think? Aunt Eloise asked as she walked into my shop, Let It Be. She held out her Havana brown cat, Elton, dressed in a green alien costume. That costume really brings out the color of his eyes, I said. My cat, Everett, meowed his agreement. Elton was Everett's uncle. My aunt had bred Havana brown cats for years until after Everett's mother died. Then she decided that encouraging people to adopt cats was a better way to go and started a Havana Brown rescue group. It's for the McMinnville UFO Festival, Aunt Eloise said. You're going, right? I winced. I forgot about it. But in my defense, all my time has been taken up by the Let It Be second anniversary celebration this weekend. It's only Monday, and the festival doesn't start until next Wednesday, so you have plenty of time to get ready. I'm sure Everett is looking forward to it. My only living relative, and near and dear to my heart, Aunt Eloise was a tall woman with the large bones of our pioneering ancestors. At least, that's how I like to think of it. Anyone who's played Oregon Trail, the computer game, knows it took hardy stock to make it all the way out to the Oregon coast. Eloise had grown up in Oceanview, Oregon, along with my mother. I, myself, had spent only 3 years in town before going away to college. But over 2 years ago, I returned and started Let It Be, a shop featuring honey and bees in a 1920s building just off Main Street and a few blocks from the beach. I'm bringing Emma and Evangeline. You know how Everett gets jealous when his sisters get to do fun things and he's left out. Everett meowed his thoughts on the matter. I sighed. It had been years since I'd been to the UFO festival. Based on a UFO sighting in McMinnville in the 1950s, the festival was equal parts campy, with parades and vendors selling alien souvenirs, and serious, with speakers discussing the science behind sightings. Fine, I said. We'll go for the parade and shopping, but I'm not dressing up. Oh, goody! Aunt Eloise pulled a silver costume out of the pocket of her long cardigan sweater. I made him this. What do you think, Everett? She held up the metallic spacesuit. He jumped down from the cashier counter and walked to her. Aunt Eloise bent down, and Everett sniffed the suit delicately, then meowed and rubbed up against her leg. He likes it! She straightened. The smile was wide in her strong face. Her gray hair was held in a bun on top of her head, and I caught a whiff of her orange blossom perfume. Now we can all watch the parade in style. Wait until you see my costume. I have a necklace that looks like a collar. The cats are the owner, and I'm the pet. Well, that's certainly true of all cats, I teased. But I'm not wearing a costume. You said that already. She pouted a moment, then broke into a wide smile. Is it okay if I ask Sally Hendrickson to come with us? She would wear a costume. She's into cosplay. Yes, that's fine, I said. The bells on the door to the shop jangled, and my sales manager, Portia Allen, stepped inside the door. She shook off her umbrella, folded it, and walked into the shop. Not busy today? She looked around the currently customer-free store. We had a nice rush this morning, but between the rain and school getting out soon, there's a bit of a lull, I said. Typical Monday, Portia said, as she put her umbrella into the holder behind the cashier stand and pulled off her raincoat. Portia was tall and thin, with gorgeous black hair from her Korean mother and sparkling blue eyes from her American father. Today she wore jeans, black booties, and a green sweater. Hey, Eloise, what's up? We're going to the UFO festival in McMinnville this weekend, Eloise said. Isn't Elton cute in his little green costume? She held up her kitty and placed the silver metallic costume on the counter. I brought this one for Everett. At the sound of his name, Everett jumped up on the counter and brushed by Portia so that she could stroke his brown fur. Nice, Portia said. I took the kids to that festival last year. They had a blast. I grabbed a zippered hoodie sweatshirt off the coat tree near the counter, slid it on, and then grabbed my purse. Please tell me you didn't dress up. We didn't, Portia confirmed. But the boys want to this year. Oh, good! We can all go together, Aunt Eloise said. Well, I'll let you two figure things out. I have an appointment. Thanks for coming in a bit early and covering for me, Portia. Is someone picking the kids up from school? Portia had two boys, River and Phoenix, who were 10 and 8 years old, respectively. Jason worked from home today so he can get them. Her husband, Jason, worked for a local tech company and was able to work from home whenever he wasn't traveling. Great, thanks. I've got to go see a bee wrangler about the fruit tree, honey. I headed toward the door. Tell Elias we said hi, Aunt Eloise said. I will. I waved my goodbye and pulled the hood up over my curly hair to keep it from frizzing too much in the soft rain. It rained a lot in spring on the Oregon coast. Unlike Portia and her umbrella, most natives simply put on a hooded sweatshirt and stepped out, hood up. I guess we were used to being damp. Elias Brentwood was a bee wrangler who lived in an old house on the edge of town. He'd trained me in the art of beekeeping and was my go-to guy for local honey. If Elias didn't have it, he could point me to where to get it. I got into my car and drove the mile or so it took to get there. The house was a one-bedroom shotgun style, which meant you could open the front door and shoot a gun straight through the house and kill someone in the backyard. Aunt Eloise said that a bachelor lumberjack had built it in the 1920s, and it had been neglected until Elias bought it in the 1980s. The tiny home was painted white and had sea blue shutters. Elias maintained it well. I'd known him ever since I'd gotten out of college. Most of his hives were hired out at the moment to the farmers near Mount Hood. It was fruit tree blossom season, and bee wranglers would ensure there were hives close to the blossoms. Bees typically foraged 2 miles from their hive, and even though some were thought to forage 2 to 3 times that distance, bee owners trucked hives in during blossom season to ensure the trees were properly pollinated. Elias loved his bees and wintered some of his hives behind the house. It was Elias who had helped me design the glass-walled hive that took up a portion of my shop. Bees are important to the environment, and he'd been thrilled when I told him I wanted a safe way to give my customers a look inside a working hive. He'd helped me build the hive on the exterior of my shop and introduced the queen bee and her court to the hive. It had become so successful that it was one of the biggest draws to my shop. The kids loved to come and watch the bees work, making honeycomb and depositing honey. The rain stopped and the sun came out as I walked up on the porch. I pulled my hood off, letting my curls spring out, and knocked on the door. Elias, it's Wren. There wasn't an answer. But I wasn't worried. Elias was probably out in the back with the one or two hives he hadn't hired out. I moved off the porch and followed the sidewalk around the side of the house to the back. The house didn't have a garage or even a driveway. Instead, there was a two-track alley in the back where Elias would pull his truck in and out to move the hives. I heard someone moving through the back bushes. "Elias, it's Wren!" Rounding the corner of the house, I came upon a horrifying scene. There were three hives tilted over, the roofs pushed off, and the bees swarming, angry and confused. I caught the sound of car doors slamming and saw a blue car speed away down the alley. "Elias, the bees!" Instinct had me stepping back to keep the side of the house between me and the angry bees. "Elias," I called, and peered around the house. Whoever did this must have taken off in the car. I didn't want to get stung, so I stayed on the side of the house and dialed Elias's cell phone. I could hear ringing coming from the backyard. "Elias?" The only sound was the phone ringing, and it went quiet as I was dumped into voicemail. If Elias was in the backyard, he might be hurt, or worse, attacked by the confused bees. The only safe vantage point to find out for sure would be from inside the house. I hurried around to the front of the house. The door was unlocked, and I walked into the small living room. "Elias, it's Wren. Are you okay?" I made my way quickly through the tidy kitchen to the bedroom in the back. No one was there. The bedroom was a mess of scattered papers and files on top of the made bed. I hurried to the back door that led out to a tiny screened porch. Elias lay on the ground, unmoving, while the bees swarmed around him. "Elias, don't move! I'll get help!" I knew better than to rush into a swarm of angry and confused bees. I dialed 911. 911, what is your emergency? I recognized Josie Pickler's voice. "Josie, it's Wren Johnson. I'm at Elias Bentwood's house. He's lying on the ground in his backyard and not moving. I think he's hurt." "Okay, Wren, I've got an ambulance and police on their way. Can you check for a pulse?" "No," I said. "Someone has disturbed Elias's bees. They're swarming the entire backyard. We'll need bee wranglers with protective gear." "I'll call animal control," Josie said. "Or should I call an exterminator?" "Don't call an exterminator. I don't want the bees hurt." "I'll advise the ambulance that bees are swarming," Josie said. "Have them park out front," I said. "I know another beekeeper. I'll hang up and call him." "Okay," Josie said. "Stay safe." I hung up and scrolled through my contacts to find Klaus Vanderboon's number. Klaus was a friend of Elias, and although he lived 20 miles from town, he was the only person I could think of to call.
"Hello?"
Klaus's voice was deep and comforting. "Oh, thank goodness you answered," I said. "It's Wren Johnson. I own the bee theme shop near Maine in Oceanview. I'm a friend of Elias Bentwood."
"What's going on, Wren? You sound out of breath."
"I'm at Elias Bentwood's place. Elias is on the ground and not moving. I called emergency services, but someone has vandalized his hives. Bees are swarming everywhere. I don't think we can get to Elias to help him."
Klaus muttered something dark. "I'm on my way," he said. "Don't let anyone do anything stupid to the bees."
"I'll do my best," I said. "Please hurry. I don't know how badly Elias is hurt." Klaus hung up the phone, and I walked back through the house to the front porch to wait for emergency services to arrive. I had some practice working with beehives, but they had always been docile. As angry as these bees were, there was no way I could reach Elias without help. I heard sirens in the distance,
and ran off the porch to the street to wave them over. It was a police car. Officer Jim Hampton parked the car. Riding with him was another officer I didn't know.
"What's going on?"
Jim asked when he opened his car door. "It's Elias," I said. "He's on the ground in the back, but someone has attacked the bees and they're too angry for me to get to Elias." The second officer got out of the car. "I can't help," he said, his dark gaze flat. "I'm allergic to bee stings. Got an EpiPen in the glove box."
"Show me where Elias is," Jim said.
He was 6 feet tall, had blue eyes and a tan face, and looked a bit like the actor Paul Newman.
"Ashton, check out the house."
"It's open," I said. "I found the door unlocked and went inside to get a better look at the backyard." Jim frowned at me.
"Elias was in the backyard, and you went into the house?"
"Yes," I said. "It was the only way to safely see the entire backyard. It's how I found Elias." We took off down the sidewalk as I continued to explain. "I called Klaus Vanderboon. He's the closest bee wrangler, but he's about 15 minutes out." Jim followed behind me. I stopped at the corner and peered around the side of the house. Jim stepped around me and then ducked back beside me.
"Those are some angry bees. Any thoughts on how to handle them? Should we smoke them?"
"Smoke them?" I asked.
"You know, smoke tends to calm bees."
"I think that only works if you are gently moving parts of the hive," I said. "You need protective gear and maybe a bee box to capture them."
"I'll call it in."
He grabbed his radio. As he spoke into it, I crouched down, wondering if I could somehow crawl slowly toward Elias, but the bees swarmed the entire backyard.
"Ashton,"
I heard Jim say into the radio when I moved back beside him.
"Yeah, boss,"
the radio crackled.
"Can you see anything from inside the house?"
Jim asked.
"I'm looking out the bedroom window. Bees are swarming the back porch as well as the yard. Looks like we have one man down and three hives demolished. I don't see how whoever did this got away without being stung multiple times."
"I'll put a call into the ER to watch for bee attacks," Jim said.
"Can you tell if Elias is moving?"
"I'm not seeing any motion," Officer Ashton said.
"Looks like maybe blood pooling near his head. Also, the back bedroom looks tossed."
"I can hear the ambulance," I said, and hurried back to the front of the house. The ambulance arrived, and I rushed to the driver's side. EMT Sarah Ritter stepped out. She was 5'9" with short brown hair and serious eyes.
"What do we have?" she asked, as she headed to the back of her rig to get out her equipment.
"Bees," I said. "Are you allergic?"
"Nope,"
she replied, and opened the back door. I saw Jim go into the house as the second EMT came around and parked behind the ambulance. It was Rick Fender. He was my height and rail thin with bleached blonde hair and a surfer look. He grinned at me.
"Maybe you can lure them out with that honey candy you make."
"There are three hives of angry bees," I said. "I don't think my candy is going to soothe them. I hope you're not allergic."
"I'm not," he said, and grabbed the end of a stretcher.
"Where's the victim?" Ritter asked. "He's in the backyard, but the bees are there too, and they're swarming. Listen, I called a bee wrangler." I glanced at my phone. "He should be here in about 10 minutes.
"The victim could be dead by then," Ritter said, and pulled the stretcher and her kit toward the side of the house.
"I don't think you understand," I said. "The bees are bad."
"I'm not afraid of a few stings," Ritter said, and moved quickly down the side of the house.
"Fine," I said, and threw up my hands. "Don't say I didn't warn you." They rounded the back of the house
and I counted to myself. 5, 4, 3. Both EMTs came scrambling back to the side of the building without the stretcher. Ritter waved a bee from in front of her face and stopped next to me. That's more than a few angry bees. You run the honey shop. Do you have a bee suit? No, I only wrangled for a season and used one of Elias's suits, I said. How far out is the bee wrangler? Jim asked as he and Officer Ashton stepped off the porch. I glanced at my phone. Maybe 10 minutes? Is there anything we can do in the meantime? Elias could be dying. I hate to break it to you, Jim said, but until we get those bees under control, there's no getting to Elias. I can try a hazmat suit, Sarah said. We have a couple back at the station. Don't know if they will be protective enough against that many bees, but it's worth a try. Go get it, Jim said. Ashton and I will stay here and monitor the situation. Dispatch wanted to call animal control, I said, but even if they have a bee suit, Klaus will get here before they can dig it out. What if Elias moves? Jim asked. Will the bees attack him? There's a chance they will, I said. Then we'd better hope he keeps his head down, Jim said. Fender, monitor the victim from a safe distance. Ritter, go get the hazmat suit. And me? I asked. Stay out of the way. Honey peanut butter cookies. Ingredients: 1/2 cup butter, 1/2 cup peanut butter, 1/2 cup honey, 1/2 cup white sugar, 1 egg, 1 teaspoon vanilla, 1 1/2 cup all-purpose flour, 3/4 teaspoon baking soda, 1/2 teaspoon baking powder, 1/4 teaspoon salt, 1/4 cup of sugar for topping. Directions. For a soft cookie, preheat oven to 325 degrees Fahrenheit. In a medium bowl, cream the butter, peanut butter, honey, and sugar. Add the egg and vanilla, stirring until combined. Add the flour, baking soda, baking powder, and salt. Beat until well combined. Line a cookie sheet with parchment paper. Roll dough into 1-inch balls and place on cookie sheet, leaving 2 inches between. Place a fork, tines flat, in the sugar and then make crosshatch marks on each cookie, dipping the fork in sugar before each cross so the dough doesn't stick to it. Bake for 15 to 18 minutes. Look for a golden brown cookie that is crisp on the outside and chewy on the inside. Remove from the cookie sheet and let cool. Makes 30 cookies. Enjoy. Chapter 2. That's a mess, Klaus said as he eyed the backyard. He wore a full bee suit with gloves and carried a helmet in his hands. Is there anything you can do to calm them? I asked. Not really, he said. Elias hasn't moved? Not an inch, I replied. It could mean he's hiding from the bees, Klaus said. Except for the pool of blood we can see around his head, EMT Ritter said. What's the plan? Well, to start, that hazmat suit might help. But chances are, if you go into that swarm, you will be stung no matter how well you're protected, Klaus said. I'll take that chance, Ritter said. Then we'll go in slow. The number one rule is to act calm. We will walk slowly along the edge of the porch. When we are directly in front of Elias, then we will walk slowly and calmly to him. Chances are that's when we'll be stung the most, as we will be approaching the hives. And you can't just smoke them? Jim asked. Smoking the bees is a diversion. It makes them feel as if the hive is under attack, and they digest as much honey as possible to save it.
These bees are beyond that. I would love to get in there and recover the queens and reset the hives, but that will take a lot of time, Klaus said.
Time we don't have, Ritter said. Let's go in.
Wait, how are you going to remove Elias? I asked.
We are going to slowly and calmly two-man lift him, Ritter said. No sudden jerking movements.
When we bring him out, there will be bees that follow us, so I recommend that everyone stay back and away from the ambulance, Klaus said, his pale blue gaze serious. Anyone who has a bee allergy needs to move at least a block away.
That's me, Officer Ashton said.
Ashton, call the ER. Let them know there will be live bees on the victim, Officer Hampton said.
Got it.
Ashton pulled out his radio and walked quickly away from the house and the emergency vehicles. Somewhere in the mix, the fire truck had shown up, but I cautioned them from hosing the bee swarm. Bees could be badly hurt from that kind of water pressure, and it wouldn't help Elias. The firemen hung out on the side of the road. We all watched as the bee wrangler and EMT calmly and carefully walked the same path along the back of the house. Bees swarmed the screened porch and the two people. They stopped and counted to 10 before they moved away from the porch and toward Elias. Unable to take off their gloves to feel for a pulse or check for neck injuries, they both squatted and slowly lifted Elias to sitting. His head lolled, and the bees buzzed louder. I listened as the EMT and the bee wrangler stopped until things settled. Next, they slowly put Elias's arms around their necks, then lifted him to his feet by holding his wrists. It was clear Elias was not conscious. His head lolled to the side, and his skin was a funny blue color. Bees swarmed around their heads. I hated to think how badly Elias was getting stung. If he survived the fall, he might not survive the stings. The two slowly and calmly retraced their steps, dragging Elias between them. We scattered as they rounded the corner of the house, bringing bees with them. Retreating to the safety of the car, I watched as the two loaded Elias into the ambulance and shut the door. Sirens blaring, the ambulance took off down the street. Calmly, Klaus retreated to the back of his pickup and sat on the tailgate, waiting for the bees to settle. The fire truck left with the ambulance, but Jim Hampton sat in his squad car and waited, as I did, for things to calm down. 20 minutes went by, and Klaus got up and walked toward the squad car. He took off his helmet and motioned for Jim to roll down his window. Jim opened the door instead and got out. I got out as well. Bees still hovered around Klaus, but were more calm.
How long until we can get the swarms under control? Jim asked.
If we do nothing, it could be days or weeks, depending on what the queens decide, Klaus said. If I have your permission, I'd like to call in a few friends and see if we can't save the hives.
Jim's mouth set in a straight line. I was radioed that Elias was pronounced DOA when he got to the ER, Jim said. That means this is a crime scene. If you bring in a bunch of people, they can ruin any evidence we may be able to collect.
Look, those bees could swarm so long all the evidence would be lost and the bees could be lost, Klaus said. Let's see if we can't get your crime scene under control.
We already lost Elias, I said. Let's save his bees.
I'll make the call, Jim said, and got back into his squad car, closing the door to keep us out. I put my hand on Klaus's shoulder and walked toward my car.
I have some bottled water, I said.
Let's get you something to drink.
Thanks.
I knew from experience that bee suits were hot, and if he got the permission he needed to save the bees, he'd be wearing his for hours. I opened my car door and grabbed a bottle from the back seat. I keep water in the back as a rule, I said. You never know when you might need it. I handed him the water. How badly are you stung?
I've been worse, he said, and twisted the cap off the bottle.
Did you find Elias?
Yes, I said. I wanted to talk with him about branching out on my locally sourced honey supplies.
Did you see who did this?
No, just a car speeding away, I said, and frowned.
What's going to happen to the bees?
I've put in a call to the Tillamook chapter of the Beekeepers Association. Several members have stepped up to help me save the hives. We need to get in there and see how the queens are doing. They might have already left the hives. If so, it's a dead deal.
And if you can save them, where will they go? I asked.
Not sure, Klaus said, and rubbed his bearded chin. Depends on whether Elias had a will or not. Do you know?
We were good friends, but not that close, I said. Just then, a small purple pickup truck screeched to a halt in front of Elias's house. Millie Brown rushed out, slamming the door behind her.
I got a call for beekeepers. Is Elias all right?
Millie was in her mid-40s, bone thin, with gray hair pulled back in a long braid. She wore a waffled, long-sleeved tee under a plaid shirt with the sleeves rolled up, exposing the tee sleeves, jeans, and thick hiking boots.
Brace yourself, Klaus said, and put his hand on her shoulder. Elias is dead.
What? No!
She pushed past us to the house.
Elias!
She went inside before Officer Hampton could stop her. I could hear her tearing through the place, with Jim calling her name as we approached the porch. Officer Hampton brought her outside and sat her down on the small front porch stoop.
I'm sorry, Millie, he said softly.
But we had a date tonight, she said. Her eyes were wide and her mouth trembled. She glanced at me. You found him?
I nodded. Millie, Jim said, you and Elias were dating?
We're engaged,
she said, and held out her left hand to show off a ring that had two bees sleeping together in a flower.
We were meeting tonight to talk about wedding venues.
Do you have any idea who might want to hurt him? Jim asked.
No,
she shook her head.
He was a great guy, loving and considerate.
Her gaze washed over us.
Why would anyone do this?
Maybe he caught them sabotaging his hives, Jim suggested. No, Klaus and I said at once. They had to have vandalized the hives to cover what they did to Elias, Klaus went on. There's no way they could have stayed in the yard to hurt him with the bees swarming.
Did they hurt the bees? Millie asked.
The hives have been vandalized, Klaus said. It's why I put out the call. We need to get to them and see if we can find and save the queens.
I've got my gear, Millie said and stood.
Are you sure you're up to this? Klaus said. You've just had a shock.
Those bees might be all I have left of Elias, she said, her expression grim. Let's get started.
I watched as she strode to her pickup and grabbed beekeeping gear out of the passenger seat.
Millie has grit, Jim said. Did you know they were dating?
No, I said. I've been busy and hadn't talked to Elias in a couple of months. A stab of guilt went through me.
We were friends for years, and I didn't really know him.
It happens, Jim said.
It doesn't happen to me, I whispered.
More patrol cars pulled up, and cops got out. Then Allison McGovern parked her SUV, grabbed her kit, and got out. I stepped aside as Jim pointed them inside the house. Allison was a no-nonsense CSU. There was no point in doing anything but sending her a small wave of acknowledgement. Within minutes, two more beekeepers arrived, and soon there were five people working on the swarming hives. My cell phone rang.
Oh, Portia, I said. I'm sorry. I got hung up.
I heard, Portia said. Three people have come into the store looking for you. They heard about Elias and the bee swarm.
Did the bees kill him?
Not unless they could bash him in the head with a blunt object, I said. When they pulled him out, I saw blood on his face. A lot of blood.
Wow, Portia said. Hey, did you know Elias and Millie Brown were engaged?
Millie and Elias?
No, Portia said.
She had a cute ring with two bees sleeping in a flower, I said.
Oh, poor Millie, Portia said. I didn't know. Not that I know her or Elias that well, but I am pretty attuned to the rumor mill. If anyone knew anything about an engagement, someone would have told me.
I do count on you to keep me up to date with things going on in town, I said wryly.
Listen, the kids are out of school in 15 minutes, and Jason is stuck in a meeting. May I call your aunt to come mind the store?
Wren!
I turned to see Aunt Eloise pushing through the crowd with a bee suit in her hands.
Brought you a suit when I heard about the swarm.
Portia, I said, and pointed at my phone. She needs to go pick up her kids from school. Jason's stuck in a meeting.
Aunt Eloise handed me the gear.
Tell her I'll be right there.
Thanks, I said to my aunt.
I heard, Portia said through my phone. Good luck bee wrangling.
Thanks.
I hung up and pulled the bee suit on. I might have had only a year of bee wrangling behind me, but it didn't mean I couldn't help. Suited up, I walked around to the backyard. The bees were still angry, but the wranglers had gotten two of the hives put back together.
Wren, go get the smokers out of the back of my pickup, Millie said. We've got two of the queens.
Got it, I said, and hurried back to the pickup. I grabbed the smokers and lighted them, carefully putting the lids on so that we could concentrate the smoke where we wanted it. I glanced over to see that barriers had been put up at the end of the block to keep the looky-loos safely away from the bees. I brought the smokers, and we were able to calm down the bees with queens. But the third hive was lost. I could see the tears in Millie's eyes.
I don't think the queen is dead, I said. They will move on and we will find them.
She nodded, and as I reached out to pat her shoulder, her knees crumpled. I put my arm around her and walked her away from the backyard crime scene to her pickup. We took off our bee hoods, and I opened her front door so she could sit down on the seat.
I'm sorry. Oh no, you are doing so well. Thank you for helping with the bees. Oh, Elias, what happened?
She put her head down into her hands. You don't know anyone who might have done this? I asked.
No, Elias was well liked.
She looked at me.
You found him?
I did, I said. I didn't see it happen, but I did see a blue sedan race away down the alley. Do you know if Elias knew anyone with a car like that?
No, she said. I don't think so. I can't think.
It's okay, I said. It's a shock. Do you need someone to drive you home? I'd like to talk to her first.
Officer Hampton said from behind me. Oh, okay, I said. I should get back to my shop anyway. The sun was setting, and things had calmed down as much as they could.
Good idea, Jim said as I moved away from him. I'll call you later.
I took one last look at Elias's home, got into my car, and left. It seemed like a lifetime since I had been on my way to make a quick stop at a friend's house to discuss new suppliers. Parking around the back of the shop, I went in by the back door. The shop itself was bright after the darkness that was falling outside.
Aunt Eloise? In the front! She called back.
I walked through the small hallway where I had coat hooks on the wall and a place to leave rain gear. Luckily, tonight there was no rain, an unusual occurrence for May in Oregon. The honey store was warm and bright. It smelled like candles and hand cream. I preferred to stick to essential oils when I made my products. It kept things natural and brought out the beauty of the products.
There she is, Aunt Eloise said as I stepped into view. Wren, I'd like you to meet
Travis Hutton, I said, and stopped cold.
Hello, Wren, he said. It's been a while.
It had been 5 years, 7 months, and 8 days, but I wasn't going to let him know I'd been keeping track. Chapter 3. Honey has been used as a salve on burns for centuries. It has been proven to prevent infections and reduce the time required for burns to heal. Travis Hutton was 6'2" of brawn, brains, and blue eyes that could melt my heart a block away. His dark hair was long and pulled up into a man bun. It didn't matter if the style was old. He made everything look hot. Lucky for me, I was dressed in full beekeeping gear. That way, he couldn't see the flush that went over most of my body. I couldn't hide the blush in my cheeks unless I put the hood back on, and I wasn't going to be that person.
Oh, you two know each other, Aunt Eloise said with a smile and a wave of her hand.
Wonderful. Then there's no reason why we can't all sit down for dinner tonight. I'll cook, of course. Everett sat on top of the cashier's counter and peered at Travis with interested eyes. Knowing my cat, he could tell how excited I was to see Travis. I swallowed hard and tried to remain calm. Someone has to watch the store, I said. You two go ahead. I waved my gloved hand toward the door.
Eloise told me her niece had opened a honey store in Oceanview, Travis said. She didn't tell me you were her niece. I think we can hold dinner until after you close.
He made a show at looking at the hours of operation in the window.
9 p.m., is it? I don't mind a late dinner.
I had to work hard not to give him the stink eye.
Of course we can eat late, Aunt Eloise said. She was in full-on flirt mode now, and I didn't blame her one bit. Travis was the type of guy women, young and old, want to be around.
Wren, if you don't mind, I'm going to run to the store and pick up the ingredients for my magic lasagna.
She put her hand on Travis's arm.
You're going to love it.
I'm sure I will, he said. We watched my aunt grab her jacket from the hooks and wave to us as she left through the back door. There was a stillness in the shop. The faint sound of music played around us. I struggled for something to say. He stuck his hands in his pockets.
I didn't know you were Eloise's niece.
I turned and moved behind the counter. I didn't know you knew my aunt.
How do you know my aunt? Aren't you supposed to be in Tokyo?
Has it really been that long?
His voice was velvet to my ears. I pulled off the gloves I was wearing, set them on the counter, and looked him in the eye.
Right. Well, I've been out of Tokyo for 3 years, he said. I went from Tokyo to London to Seattle. I'm living in Seattle now. He took a step toward the counter, and I took a step back.
That's a 2-hour drive from here, I pointed out.
I like driving, he said.
Why are you here? I blurted out, trying to figure out what to do with my hands.
I met Eloise at the Portland night market. She was working a booth for the Havana Brown Cat Rescue Group. We got to talking about cats, and she invited me to Oceanview to pick out a new pet.
Everett had taken a shine to Travis. He paced in front of him, rubbing up against the black wool coat that stretched across Travis's wide chest. Travis reached out and ran his hand along Everett's fur. My cat purred up a storm.
Oh, that's right, I said, and sent him a smile. You love cats.
It's how we met, he said. You were walking Everett on campus. I was sitting on a bench doing my homework.
Everett was less than a year old, I said.
My cat meowed at the sound of his name. He kept pacing the countertop in front of Travis to get pets.
Such a clever cat, Travis said. He's the reason I met your aunt. I remembered this girl I'd fallen for once having a Havana Brown, and I wanted one.
That was a long time ago, I said, and swallowed hard.
When I met your aunt? No, that was just last week.
When you knew that girl, I said. Before you chose your career over her and broke her heart.
He lifted his hand and stepped back from the counter. I don't remember it that way. He sent me a small smile. But then I was young and not ready to settle down.
The door to the shop opened, and Officer Hampton strode inside. The bells jangled as the door closed behind him. Hey, I said, are you finished with the crime scene already?
Crime scene? Travis asked.
There wasn't much left to process once the bees were contained, Jim said. He glanced at Travis and back at me.
Do you have time for a few questions?
Sure, I said.
Are you a customer? Jim asked.
Oh, Officer Jim Hampton, this is Travis Hutton, I said. We went to college together. He's here to adopt a cat through my aunt's rescue program. The two men shook hands. They sized each other up for a moment, and then Travis turned toward me.
I'll leave you to your questions. I'm looking forward to dinner later, Wren.
He nodded and left the shop. Jim watched him go and then turned to me.
Old flame?
Is it that obvious? I'm a trained observer, he said.
I see you're still wearing the beekeeper's suit.
He pointed toward my outfit. I haven't had time to change. I pushed my bangs back out of my eyes. Do you know what killed Elias?
The autopsy will be done tomorrow or the next day, Jim said. Do you have time to go over what happened today?
Sure, I said, and unzipped the suit. I stopped by Elias's place to talk about local suppliers. He didn't answer the door, so I went around the back to see if he was outside working with the bees. That's when I saw the swarms and a blue sedan drive off in a hurry. I checked to see if Elias was inside and if he'd seen what the vandals did, but he wasn't inside. So I looked out the bedroom window and saw him on the ground.
Did you get a license plate number on the car? He asked.
I closed my eyes and thought back. No, I wasn't at a good angle to see it. The sedan was older, though. I think maybe American, like Ford or GM. Sorry, I'm not the most knowledgeable when it comes to cars.
Whoever did this, more than likely, got stung more than once, Jim said. I've got word out at the local hospitals and clinics in case they get a walk-in.
Any idea who would want to hurt Elias? I asked.
No, he said. Everyone I've talked to, from his neighbors to his girlfriend Millie, tells me he's a nice guy. He wasn't into drugs or anything illegal.
I've known Elias for 3 years, I said. I studied bee wrangling under him. He is, was, the past president of the Tillamook chapter of the Beekeepers Association of America.
Are there any rivalries in the association? Jim asked.
What do you mean?
These kinds of associations are pretty political. Could someone from the association want Elias dead? Jim studied me.
No, I said. No, it couldn't have been anyone from the association.
Why not?
Because we all see bees as an endangered species. Not a single one of us would ever harm a hive or risk destroying a colony like these killers did.
So you think I can scratch off the Beekeepers Association members from my list of folks to investigate? He said.
Oh, I think you'll look into whatever you think you should look into, but you're not going to find a killer there. Besides, wasn't Elias's bedroom searched? Maybe this has nothing to do with bees at all.
What would it be about then? He asked. What else was Elias involved in?
I leaned back against the back shelves. That's the question of the day, isn't it? I wish I knew.
All right. If you think of anything else, let me know, he said. You have my number.
I do, I said, and I will.
He studied me for a moment. Try to keep out of the investigation this time, okay?
I'm a store owner, not a private detective, I said.
That's the right answer, he said. Thanks, Wren.
I watched him leave my store and glanced at the clock on the wall. It was 8:00. 1 hour left before dinner with Travis at Aunt Eloise's home. What the heck was I going to wear?
You had dinner with Travis Hutton? Portia said the moment she walked into the back door of the shop the next morning. The Travis Hutton? The man who ran off to Tokyo with the cute co-ed and left you with a broken heart?
It was Tuesday, and the shop wouldn't open for another 30 minutes. I brewed coffee for the coffee bar, where we offered people a chance to try different honeys in their beverage.
Yes, I said, and took the tall carafe off the brewer and placed the pump top on it. Okay, spill. What happened? Is he still drop-dead gorgeous? Did he come crawling back to beg forgiveness? Did you slap his face? Did he give you a toe-curling kiss and beg you to take him back?
No, I said, and added some pretty spring candles to the candle display.
What happened?
Nothing, I said.
She grabbed me by the forearms. I don't believe that. I happen to know you still have feelings for him.
It's been 5 years, I said with a long breath. People change.
Then what did you talk about?
Cats, I said, and went to the cash register to count out the money for the day. He's adopting one of Aunt Eloise's rescue cats.
Okay. And?
And he's living in Seattle now, still working for an international company in sales management, I said, as I closed the register, ensuring everything was ready for opening.
Only 2 hours away? Wonderful, Portia said. So, are you going to see him again? He didn't ask, I said, and studied her. Portia was a lovely blend of both of her parents, Korean-American and German-American.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.